Hello everyone, welcome to Study IQ. Myself Dr. Ravi Agrari. We are going to start the August month current affair issues for the environment, ecology and biodiversity. So this is the third video guys, and in two videos I already discussed a lot of information, how to go and what to do. So every information I already discussed earlier. So as you know, in the beginning I just to inform you which chapters are relevant and you should follow for your UPSC preparation. The one that is the unit one as the basics of ecology and its related concepts with the many chapters. The second unit that you should go for the climate change, the climatic parameters, many chapters still here. The third one is the international conference and summits. The fourth one is different regulatory bodies, laws and acts in India. Later on you should go into the fifth unit, that is a environmental impact assessment. See, this is the only for the mains paper. It is not relevant for your prelims examination. The next unit is the pollution and solid waste management. The seventh unit you should go for the biomes, natural vegetation and floristic region. As you know, this is the environmental geography. This is environmental geography part. Next unit is the biodiversity, wildlife conservation and species recovery program. And the last one is a miscellaneous topic. Again, in the beginning, I will tell you a few things you should remember always. The one, the subject basic, which is required in your preparation. The second one, there are applied areas, and later on you should go into the there are related current affair issues. So basics and applied part I already explained you in my traditional lectures in my classroom program, and even this is also mentioned in my book. For contemporary issues I'm here guys, and in the contemporary issues I already explained two more videos earlier. So if you are here, so better you go first in the first two videos. And now you follow, this is the third video of the contemporary issues for UPSC prelims 2019. See, this video will be not only useful for UPSC, a part of this all other state PCS examination, that all examination will held in 2019. And same video you also keep it, even save for your mains 2019. Okay, so there is a lot of importance of these all videos. So let us start guys. In the beginning, I will just tell you, because many people ask me, many students ask me, so where is all the videos? So this videos, even PPTs. So yeah, this PDF. So this PDF is available on my Facebook page. If you want, you can go there and directly download there. And see, you can also follow me in my Instagram profile. I'm also available there. See that all the topics which are relevant in this month, August month current affair issues. Here the first topic, that is India's national RED strategy, those India form. And now India is going to submit to UNFCCC. This is the topic, current affairs based from unit 3. See, whatever the India is going to submit RED framework and everything, the RED, you know, this background will start actually from UNFCCC. And the background of UNFCCC, so RED background is UNFCCC, and UNFCCC background is what is the Earth Summit or Rio Summit. For the safety and security of the Earth, in 1992, one of the summit held in Rio de Janeiro, those also got popular with the name of Rio Summits. Actually, in the Rio Summits have a five document those released. The one is the Rio Declaration. The second is the Forest Principle. The third is the Agenda 21. The fourth one is UNFCCC. And the fifth one is CBD. Under Agenda 21, after 2 years, UNCCD Board. Okay, everybody. That is United Nations Convention for Combat Desertification, against the desertification to the world guys. Okay, but here UNFCCC is an important one here again, that is United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, it came in force in 1994, and the first summit of UNFCCC that held in 1995, that was COP1. You know guys, the purpose of UNFCCC was especially to stabilize the environment against greenhouse gases. So those emission of in the atmosphere, the greenhouse gases is going to generate guys, that should be stabilized, neither it will create a lot of problem to the environment. The main reason behind the climate change, you know, it's a global warming right now. So for that emission reduction purposes, greenhouse gases emission reduction purposes, UNFCCC is working a lot. And that UNFCCC, the first meeting was, that is conference of party number one, COP number one meeting 1995. And this meeting was continue. In 2011, that UNFCCC 11 meeting, conference of parties number 11, if you count, you will get it. Okay, here REDD born. So RED, those born, that full form is what? That is a reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation. Again, I repeat, reducing emission from deforestation and forest degradation. You know, what is the purpose of this REDD? The purpose of REDD ultimately, when we people do the deforestation, okay, if you go against the deforestation, yeah, we'll go against the forest degradation. The finally, we people will reduce the emission level of CO2. So those emission level of CO2 is going to generate there, guys. Okay, that CO2 will be fixed when we people increase the afforestation or increases the forest availability in the particular areas. So this is the reason, guys, here the reducing emission from the deforestation and forest degradation. For that purpose, REDD came. REDD came in COP11, as I told you, it was a UNFCCC summit and that was held in 2005. See, on the purpose was to converse about reducing emission through deforestation and forest degradation. See, this REDD, that is COP11, that further being changed after 2 years, and here the initiatives has been taken by India. So with the initiative of India, the REDD being changed after 2 years, that is the COP13 meeting, and that held in the Bali, Indonesia, and here it can become popular as REDD+. You know what came under REDD+? Under REDD+ have a incentive provisions. Incentive provision means have a some funding provision, and through the help of this funding, you know, developed country will provide the funding to the developing nations, and with the help of this funding, guys, developing country will introduce a lot of forestation in their own area, and finally that will increase the carbon sink. So in the atmosphere, the carbon emission is going to generate, it will reduce. So this is the REDD+. And see, under the REDD, again, reforestation and degradation against it, you know, under REDD have a poverty alleviation is also one of the component. Why poverty alleviation, guys? Definitely when you people will remove the poverty in the rural areas, in the particular areas, the people stop to burn wood and will start to shift toward the LPG users. So this is the reason I'm telling you guys, if you want to maintain the environment and a sustainable environment, the better you should reduce the poverty. So poverty alleviation was also one of the key component under REDD+. It was a prelims question in 2015. Okay, everyone, fine. So now you come here under the REDD+ after 2 years of COP11, that was in Bali, and here the Bali roadmap form. Under Bali roadmap, many provision came. The one GI provision, joint implementation. The second one is a clean development mechanism, and third one is a carbon trading. See, before this COP summits, I'm telling you, before COP13 summits, earlier there was also a discussion about the GI, CDM and carbon trading, but the proper structure of joint implementation, clean development mechanism and carbon trading form under Bali roadmap. Okay, so the purpose of Bali roadmap, the REDD+, and here you know very well about allocation of funding to developing countries. Purpose, to reduce the carbon emission. Okay, and how it is possible? Through forest cover and not indulging in deforestation. So these are the reasons through you people will increase the forestation. REDD+, focuses on the reducing the emission of greenhouse gases in atmosphere through sustainable forest management and mitigating the effect of climate change by reducing deforestation and promoting afforestation. So reduce deforestation and promote afforestation was the main purpose of REDD+, and for that purpose, the main difference is the funding here that was not earlier, guys. See, what type of concepts those you will access here through the help of these three terms. The one is the REDD, the second one is the REDD+, and third one is the REDD++. See, REDD++ is not much more authentic, but I got somewhere have a data about the existence of REDD+, so I just to introduced here. REDD, you know very well, reducing emission from the deforestation and the forest degradation. See what type of changes in the REDD+, even if have a funding, guys. Okay, if developed countries are ready to provide, see REDD+, wagera, this type of things only for developing country. Okay, only for developing countries. Okay, and see guys, developing country have a good weightage. If developing country will involve into the reduction of greenhouse gases, so at international level, the UNFCCC will become successful against greenhouse gases emission reduction. The reason is, guys, developed country introduce industrialization, but what about the vegetation? What about the biodiversities are very less? But what about developing country? Here, biodiversity areas are very high. So better if you increases the forestation, afforestation and reforestation type of things in the developing country, so finally you can increase the carbon sink at the global level. Okay. under IDD plus, because of funding guys, sustainable forest management will be introduced, even increases, boost up, conservation of forest will boost up, and enhancement of carbon sink. Definitely when these two part will over, means when we become successful in the sustainable forest management and conservation of forest, so finally we will increase the carbon sink. And what will come into the RED plus? Okay, that's not very important and not so much popular and not so much authentic. When I got this information and later on I searched for many sites, I could not access the more information about RED plus. But somewhere is given as a RED plus will have a more biodiversity area, you will increase, and finally low carbon content will come in the atmosphere. So this is the RED plus. But for you people guys, RED plus is most important, not RED plus plus. This was also the question in UPSC prelims 2015 or 16 prelims examination. Now, national REDD strategy. Okay, India has prepared on the basis of UNFCCC, UNFCCC decisions. See how you will get it, the national REDD strategy work. Definitely guys, REDD strategy work with because of many things. Even India has started their own national action plan on climate change, even Green India Mission, even India's intentionally, even INDC, intended nationally determined contribution, that name even changed right now as a nationally determined contribution to UNFCCC. India made about the nationally determined contribution that India will do from 2021 onwards till 2030. So in these 10 years, India made some target to achieve, okay, according to nationally determined contribution, and try to minimize the greenhouse gas emission by certain base year, on the basis of certain base year. See, the strategic report has been prepared in India by Indian Council of Forestry Research and Education, Dehradun. Okay, and the next one guys, India has prepared the national RED plus strategy, and soon it will be communicated to the UNFCCC. So this is the information those I told you earlier. Now, RED plus, as you know, the main important information as a bold here I would like to read out. See, my contents are some more here. The reason is because I am going to focus the key points here, but the beginning and some other information those I not said here, at least it will help you to connect and to understand this information those I just to explain here. This is the reason some more extra information I just to write here. Okay, so you don't worry, but this material when you will not listen me in that time you read out, so you'll be much more familiar with other concepts. So it creates a financial value, as I told you, that was not in a RED. So RED plus creates a financial value for the carbon stored in the forest by offering incentives for developing countries to reduce the emission from forested lands and invest in low carbon part to the sustainable development. And see, those funding even will release to the country, it will be depend on their own growth and their own initiatives, those they brought in their own country and try to reduce the greenhouse gases emissions. So developing countries would receive a results based payment for result based action. So on the basis of result based action, you will access a result based payment, as I told you. Okay, and definitely guys, with the help of all these things, there will be enhancement of the forest carbon stock. Now we go to the second unit based contemporary issues, that's United Nations Environment Program. What are here under the United Nations Environment Program? So actually, you know, in this month, Satyavas Tripathi was in the news. So what was the news related to the UNEP regarding the Satyavas Tripathi? He is actually an Indian development economist, and also professionally he is a lawyer, and has been appointed as an Assistant Secretary General of UN. Okay, United Nations, and will also be head of the UNEP. UNEP office, that is in New York. So this is the news about the Satyavas Tripathi, so you should know. See, you know guys, what about the importance of UNEP? UNEP is a United Nations Environmental Program. It coordinates the various environmental activities worldwide, even also provide the various assistance to the developing countries in the implementation of various environmental policies and practices in your country. Okay, fine. Even the concept of UNEP brought after the UN conference on human environment, that was a Stockholm conference held on the 5th June 1972. Even, you know guys, after this conference, 5th June even declared as a World Environment Day. See, in this conference it was decided We should have some international body, and that will take care of environment also. And for that purpose, UN brought UNEP. So UNEP concept born under the Stockholm Conference 1972. And one more importance of Stockholm Conference, 5th June declared as a World Environment Day. See, actually UNEP has an overall responsibility on environmental problems worldwide. So various regarding the atmosphere, regarding the marine ecosystem, terrestrial ecosystem, environmental governance and green economy, in every sector UNEP is working. Okay, UNEP has many activities, and you should know about the various activities. Even it also involved to provide various funding to take various initiative in the speed of various conferences and summits. Okay, so if suppose some conference or summits are not going on, any type of problem happen, any funding is required, the UNEP is ready to provide the funding if it is related to the environment concern. Okay, and even implement the various environment related development project worldwide. You know guys, in the case of IPCC those form here World Meteorological Organization and UNEP work. To IPCC those born in 1988, here UNEP also work with Meteorological Organization, World Meteorological Organization. Now question is, what is the purpose of IPCC? IPCC, its full form is Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. See, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, it go and collect worldwide data. It go and collect worldwide data. What about the pollution level in your country? This IPCC will collect the data, and on the basis of all the data those having been collected by IPCC guys, then will make some conclusions. On the basis of this accumulating data, what about the future of the world in the respect of greenhouse gas emission? And then later on, when you go into the UNFCCC meeting, those even involved into the protection of environment against greenhouse gases, then here have some decision. Okay, IPCC time to time will assess the data, and this is the reason there is a lot of assessment report time to time IPCC provide, and on the basis of this IPCC report, under UNFCCC have a different provisions. Okay, UNEP is also one of the several implementing agencies for the Global Environmental Facility, that is the funding. Those provide the funding to take various initiatives. Even in the case of REDD+, those I taught you guys, Global Environmental Facility provide the funding to the developing country. Even multilateral fund for the implementing of Montreal Protocol, those work against the ozone depletion. In all the cases, UNEP even helps a lot. Even those green GDP we measure in economy, guys, the GDP means economical values of the diversity, those we check, that even also been considered. Even UNEP said, so UNEP said we should also go and consider the green GDP. Even the GDP values we should measure and connect with the environment and diversity. Even Champions of the Earth Award, though this year our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi received, it also brought by UNEP. Even Global 500 Award, okay, the Champions of the Earth is award is the successor of Global 500 Award. If you read my book third unit, so this information I explained there. Champions of the Earth Award is the important question for this year. In the coming month, I will discuss with you in the contemporary issues of environment part. Reason in this year, Modi got even received Champions of the Earth Award. So now you go into the next contemporary issues, where the unit 8, base contemporary issues, the World Network of Biosphere Reserves. See, Kanchenjunga Biosphere Reserves has been become as the 11th Biosphere Reserves from India, that has been included under UNESCO's designated World Network of Biosphere Reserves, that is called MAB program. MAB means Man and Biosphere Program. Okay, see, that meeting was actually held in 30th session of International Coordination Council of Man and Biosphere Program on 23rd to 28th July 2018 in Indonesia. So in this conference, program, okay, under this meeting, guys, the 11th Biosphere Reserves of India included in Man and Biosphere Program. Overall, you can say the 10th already included, the one more 11th included here. Okay, even Kanchenjunga National Park, these areas even also consider in the World Heritage Sites. Those I will explain with you. Okay, World Heritage Sites. India has total 18 biosphere reserves, And in these 18 biosphere reserves, 11 has an international level under MAP program, and the 7 is a national or domestic biosphere reserves in this total 18 biosphere reserves. So biosphere reserves are a concept brought in 1971 by UNESCO under Man and Biosphere program. It is an intergovernmental scientific program. The purpose is to establish a scientific basis improvement relationship between people and their own environment. A scientific basis will connect from people to environment. Aim of the Man and Biosphere program that was brought under UNESCO. See, here we go into the study of social science, economics, education to improve human livelihoods, and see, equitable sharing of benefits, safeguard natural and manage ecosystem, all even cover together. It is an innovative approach to economic development that are socially and culturally appropriate and environmentally sustainable. Okay, so here we'll try to increase the people livelihood. Even if you will increase the livelihood, the people will not totally depend on the natural resources. Okay, just like if people will not burn the wood, people will utilize the LPG. So ultimately, you are not dependent on the natural resources, you will not exploit it. So these type of things also consider under biosphere reserves. So Kanchenjunga biosphere reserves. Okay, Kanchenjunga biosphere reserves, the some highlights is what? Kanchenjunga biosphere reserves is a national park and the biosphere reserves as a both located in the Sikkim, India. And see, this Kanchenjunga mountain areas where it spread, guys, it is the third highest peak of the world. And see, there is different areas are here, guys. Kanchenjunga National Park was designated as the World Heritage Sites in 2016 under the mixed category. World Heritage Sites are those places which have some important values, recreational values, spiritual values, cultural values, okay, any type of values. Here there is three types of the World Heritage Site. The one is a natural, the second one is a cultural, and third one is a mixed type. Mixed type means what? Where the natural and cultural both feature available. India's one and only one, and the first and one, that is the Kanchenjunga National Park, which is the mix. Neither rest of all World Heritage Sites are either natural or cultural. So what is the definition of the biosphere reserves? You know very well, guys, here the complete ecosystem is precious, means not only a species or certain organism, even that particular habitat. So overall, I'm telling you the complete ecosystem is precious in the case of biosphere reserves. So this is also a very good question in your paper. Okay, so biosphere reserves have a three objectives. What about the objectives? You can get here, guys. It's a in situ conservation of biodiversity at their own natural area. In situ means those conservation we are doing at their own natural sites. We are not going to create artificial condition for the conservation of a particular organism. It's a sustainable economic development and to provide the facilities for long-term ecological studies, environmental educations, various training and research, and their own monitoring for environmental benefits. Now we go into the next objectives, contemporary issues based on Unit 8. Topic is a cheetah reintroduction project. See, actually Madhya Pradesh Forest Department has written to a National Tiger Conservation Authority, especially to revive a plan to reintroduce cheetah in the state, especially in Nora Dehi Sanctuary. Okay, see, this ambitious project even brought in 2009, but in that time it was not become successful. Reason that was a lack of funding. Okay, still here the Madhya Pradesh government, even here department, Forest Department is advising and even said request to the National Tiger Conservation Authority to reintroduce cheetah in this sanctuary. Okay, fine. The scientific name of cheetah is the Echinornis jubatus, and it's the oldest big cat species. Even that ancestors came in this geological time scale during Miocene era. Okay, cheetah reintroduced program, even earlier it was introduced in the Wildlife Institute of India at Dehradun. They prepare around 260 crore rupees cheetah reintroduction project 6 years ago on the basis of same concept. Now in Madhya Pradesh government, even Forest Department want around 25 to 30 crore rupees expenditure to build an enclosure area around 150 square kilometer for cheetah in Nora Dehi. Okay, fine. See, actually in this case, Nora Dehi is what? It is a very suitable place for the cheetah conservation. The reason is it is not very dense area. So the cheetah, that is the fastest moving animals, can move very easily. Okay, Beside the prey based on the cheetahs is also abundantly available here. So overall the food for the cheetah is abundantly here. According to earlier action plan, around 20 cheetahs were introduced or translocated to Nauradei area from Namibia, means Africa. So this Namibia Cheetah Conservation Fund has even showed its willingness to donate the feline to India, and here the 20 cheetah they have donated to India in this Nauradei. So now I hope you understood how much the conservation site of Nauradei is good for the conservation of cheetah. Okay, what about the National Tiger Conservation Authority? You should know, guys, that National Tiger Conservation Authority is the statutory body that work under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and it formed under Wildlife Protection Act 1972. It strengthened the tiger conservation in our country, okay, and provide the various guidelines for the protection of cheetah in our nation, okay. Now, unit 8 based question, that is National Tiger Conservation Authority to take over Karbet Tiger Reserves. See, Karbet Tiger Reserves right now was in the news, that is in the Nainital district, Uttarakhand area. It was established in 1936. Earlier the name was the Haile National Park. It is India's oldest and most prestigious national park. In this national park, guys, tiger conservation started from 1973 onwards. See, the Karbet National Park is totally covered around 521 square kilometer area, and it's a neighboring, have a Sona Nadi Wildlife Sanctuary and the reserve forest area where the tiger reserves still there, okay. So tiger reserves are in the Sona Nadi Wildlife Sanctuary, and the reserve forest area cover around 521 square kilometer area. See, Karbet National Park is not only for the tiger conservation, guys. Here you will also get the richest bird regions of our country, and this is the reason this area is also considered as an important bird area according to BirdLife International. See, BirdLife International was also UPSC question in 2014. It is the kind of a NGO, guys, and oldest NGO that work a lot in India, okay, for the conservation of birds. Even Amur Falcon, fowls, and for the few birds it worked a lot in India. It's the oldest conservation NGOs. Now unit 8 based the Odisha to showcase its biodiversity. See, here is a world-class interpretation center at Dangamal, that is near to Bhitarkanika National Park. Even that is the area for the protection of crocodiles. And why here the protection of crocodile is important? Because in this area have a mangrove diversities, and mangrove diversities are the good for the preservation of a conservation of what? Ghadiyal in this area, and this is the reason this was in the news, okay. So world class interpretation center at Dangamal near Bhitarkanika National Park here should introduce. See, for that purposes here the project has been approved under integrated coastal zone management projects. For that purposes 300 crore rupees allocations. Bhitarkanika in need of conservation is what? You know, that is the finest biodiversity hotspot. Receives a lot 1 lakh visitors every year, and a lot of tourists inflow in this area. See, the park is famous for green mangroves, migratory birds, turtles, estuarine crocodiles, and countless creeks are there. You know, guys, 70% of country's estuarine and saltwater crocodiles are in this area only. See, Bawla project at Dangamal is also very important. And this Dangamal is in Bhitarkanika sanctuary. It's a saltwater crocodile eggs have been collected locally, and the young crocodile have been released in the creeks. Okay, and see, in the last from 1977 onwards, if you see, around more than 2200 crocodiles even released in that area. It's a very good area. So Bawla in Uriya, its meaning is what? That is a saltwater crocodile. The Bawla area in Dangamal, it is in Bhitarkanika sanctuary. Okay. Is actually useful for the conservation of saltwater crocodile, and saltwater crocodile in India is only in this locations. See, if you go into the about the feature of ghadiyal, guys, so ghadiyal critically endangered according to IUCN red list. Ghadiyal is also called as a gavial, or it mean as a fish eating crocodile. Ghadiyal once inhabited all major river system of Indian subcontinent, even Irrawaddy river in the east to the Indus river in the west. Up to these all areas in this river belt have a presence of ghadiyal. Okay, in India, you will get as a Girwa River, Chambal River, Ken River, Son River, Mahanadi River, and Ramganga River. In that areas have a gharial. And in Nepal, if you see the Rapti Narani River, have also presence of lot of gharial. If you see the gharial conservation, the species in the Schedule 1 under Indian Wildlife Act 1972. See, Project Crocodile even introduced in India in 1975 with the effort of Government of India, even the United Nations Development Fund and Food and Agriculture Organization, they even work a lot especially for captive breeding of gharial. See, International Nitrogen Initiative, it was also on news in the September month. So, International Nitrogen Initiative is what, see guys, actually recently a Indian scientist, Nandula Raghuram, he was in news, elected as a chair of the International Nitrogen Initiative, and he was the first Indian and even Asian to be elected as a chair of International Nitrogen Initiative. See, what is the International Nitrogen Initiative? It is a program, guys, international program. That program was brought or set up in 2003 under sponsorship of SCOPE and IGBP. What are the SCOPE and IGBP? SCOPE is the Scientific Committee on the Problems of Environment, and IGBP is the International Geosphere Biosphere Program. This initiative even aims to optimize nitrogen beneficial role and minimize nitrogen negative effects on the hull. It means, guys, this nitrogen have a two points. The one, the nitrogen is positive somehow, and nitrogen is the negative somehow. Okay, how nitrogen is positive and how negative you will get into the next PPT. See, even a coordinate, it is being INI, is coordinated by a steering committee where have a one chair person and a part of this six regional directors even representing from Africa, Europe, Latin America, North America, South Asia and East Asia. See, INI hold a conference once in every 3 years and they discuss about the ideas and action the various knowledge about nitrogen issues in global world. See guys, why we should go and care about the nitrogen is very important. The one, guys, in the beginning, those nitrogen came in this earth, it was because of lightning and thundering. So first time during the origin of life and everything, guys, when the nitrogen element and nitrogen even gases come in the atmosphere, the nitrogen compounds come in the atmosphere, it came because of lightning and thundering, those happen in the sky. So it's a natural process, and a part of this, the biological nitrogen fixation, which are going to be happening to the legume crops with the help of bacteria. Those bacteria are available in the soil. It is also a kind of natural process that even happened earlier. So this nitrogen is going to fix into the form of nitrite, into the form of nitrate, into the form of ammonium. This is always common. And see, here the nitrogen is going to fix into the atmosphere, from the atmosphere into the various biological compounds are in the soil. And see, with the help of denitrification process, further have some bacteria in the atmosphere, guys, they convert all the nitrogenous compound into atmospheric nitrogen. It's a kind of nitrogen cycle, those I explained with you in ecology chapter. Okay, see, even in the case of nitrogen balance is going to be happen, it is itself happen, but human being have a dramatically altered this nitrogen balance, and finally the nitrogen is this time altered nitrogen balance means now nitrogen is not in balance, it is imbalance. And see, this type of property has been observed since 1960s. Okay, this imbalance property even accelerated sharply in this time. And see, because of this unprecedented growth in reactive nitrogen has impacted this health and welfare of the people and ecosystem worldwide. This is the reason the nitrogen should be proper recycled. It should not be not increased than the normal level. See, the reactive nitrogen is implicated in high concentration of ozone in the lower atmosphere. So ultimately, guys, when I explained with you about the ozone depletion, so under the ozone depletion, I told you there are two reasons behind the ozone depletion. One side where nature itself, and second is the anthropogenic causes. In the natural causes, I explained with you nitroxyl radical, I said about the hydroxyl radical. So nitroxyl and hydroxyl radical are responsible for the ozone depletion, but they all generate because of natural reasons. And anthropogenic have a chlorofluorocarbon, bromofluorocarbon, this is freon gas, this is halon gas. So this is the anthropogenic where human is responsible to use into the many places. Okay, so this is the reason, guys, the higher concentration of ozone in the lower atmosphere been also been affected because of nitrogen reaction. Even eutrophication in the coastal system, eutrophication means nutrient enrichment. This is what nutrients enrichment. So if nutrient availability will increase into the ponds and lakes, that is called eutrophic ponds or lakes. And the process of nutrient enrichment into the ponds or lakes, this is called eutrophication process in the coastal ecosystem also be there. If nitrogen type of compound will go into the water body, they increases the productivity into the ponds and lakes. And finally, what is there, guys, and have a depletion of oxygen level into the water body. Those I explained into the first lecture, and finally cause the BOD, biological oxygen demand, and fishes die. See, a part of this, guys, nitrogen even also create the acidification of forest, create the acidity in the soil, and the fresh water stream and lakes, and even the loss of biodiversity also being happened because of presence of nitrogen and its compounds. Even those nitrous oxide come in the atmosphere, it is a kind of greenhouse gases. Nitrogen even contributes as a global warming and stratospheric ozone depletion. It is a repeated line, those I explained with you earlier here. Okay, now the next one, guys, the world's largest 3D printed reef installed in Maldives to help save corals. So it's an artificial reefs, those even developed here, guys, and that's similar to the natural reefs. It will be helpful for us even in the conservation of corals in that areas. Okay, the world's largest 3D printed reefs has been submerged at Summer Island, Maldives. So Summer Island, Maldives have a 3D printed reefs, and the 3D printed reefs even developed with the help of ceramic and some concrete modules, which is very similar to like to the calcium carbonate made skeleton or cell. Those are in the case of coral's body. Okay, and that is being developed with the help of 3D printed. Okay, it is a 3D printer. And see, guys, one thing more, the ceramic structures built closely resemble to original structure found in the Maldives in the respect of coral reefs. See, what about the issue, guys? Right now have a lot of reason behind the death of corals, and here one of the reason is the bleaching process. See, actually corals are the association of algae and plus some group. Algae is a kind of a group of plants, and some animal groups like Coelenterata group of animal, or maybe Mollusca group of animals. Okay, they all positive interactions, and because of the positive interaction, that is called mutualism, have a formation of coral reefs. See, in the case of coral reefs, alga and coelenterates mutually beneficial. Algas are actually in the nature are of different colors. Okay, and this is the reason, guys, the corals have a different colors due to presence of alga color. Okay, what happened when this association alga die? So the color of alga, even those coral have some colors, guys. Now the color will fade up, and that case is called as a coral bleaching. Coral bleaching means the alga portion die, color even become as a colorful to white type of color, and finally the association die, and this is the case coral death. So here the bleaching process means the coral death happened. It's a dangerous condition of corals. Okay, and the color in the waters even different hues. Okay, earlier when the algas are there have a different colors. See, guys, in this cases, what about the reason? Many reasons are given. Those temperatures are going to increase into the water body, even various disposal of chemical waste into the oceans. They all, even not only these, guys, those CO2 level increases in the atmosphere when they mix up to the ocean water, they form H2CO3 as a carbonic acid, and this carbonic acid increases the what? Acidic condition into the water body and cause what? Death of corals. So 3D printer technology is hoped to offer a safety net for corals. Okay, in that case we can conserve a coral in that area. It's a very effective way of growing and restoring corals in the Maldives areas. See, what about the backgrounds here and the backgrounds of the corals? I told you, guys, in the Maldives is one of the world's most climate vulnerable nations. A lot of temperatures there, rising sea temperature is the reason, guys. They even this is the main threat of the world's coral reefs, and the mass bleaching events are becoming more common and more severe in these areas. You know, corals are generally in the tropical regions. If you go and see in Europe, you will not get the coral, guys. You go in the sea, the Arctic areas, coral is still not there. Coral actually grow worldwide in 30 degree north to 30 degrees south. Okay, and see here, it means the temperature around 25 degree, roughly plus minus 2 degrees Celsius average temperature is required. Because if global warming happen, guys, the temperature of the atmosphere increases, definitely the water body temperature increases, and finally the coral will affect and the coral die. So this is the observation here. Those current affair was here, guys. And now at last, I will advise you, you don't miss to read this book. All the conceptual part, coral reefs, coral bleaching, ocean acidification. Okay, a lot of information though they explain here, even UNFCCC, even the Earth Summit, guys. Okay, every information mentioned here and you should read out. And now you follow this all current affairs, those I explained with you. Maybe in the understanding of some concept, you people suffer a lot because you have not the basic parts. You have not the conceptual parts and you directly you are listening the current affair issues. So here you may have an issue, but don't worry, guys, you don't tense. Whatever you have right now, you follow and trust on yourself and the God. So all the best, guys. Thank you so much. Take care.